Right, on to the next one. Lecture 9 is about taxonomy, or basically the way that we organize living things into groups that are like each other. Because of the amount of diversity on the planet, whether we're talking about living things or even soil for that matter, we have developed a method of naming things using two-part names and again a system that organizes things into groups where there are similarities among those groups, so it helps us get a better handle on understanding life. So what is taxonomy again? It's basically the identification and the naming of species, and basically again that allows us to classify living things into groups. So I've got some example of fungi here. Fungi are unique enough as far as being a living thing with certain characteristics that they're in their own broad grouping. And then certainly as we work our way down to the individual species, the unique specific living thing, then we assign names to that. And those names that we use are referred to as scientific names. Basically, they are Latin names. They are named giving a Latin name because Latin is what we refer to as a dead language. Nobody on the planet, except for scientists anyway, actually speak Latin. So Latin isn't subject to changing. Just think about our modern language and how many new words pop up all the time. Prior to the internet and emails, you know, we didn't have anything, e-waste, email, and so as our society evolves and things happen, we have to, you know, or maybe we don't have to, but we do come up with new names, new terms, new phrases, and so again, we use Latin because it doesn't change. Scientists also use Latin names because the common names that are out there tend to be misleading. When I first moved to California, someone referred to a road in an area where there was a four-wheel drive trail, Tamarack Ridge. And then something came up about the trees up there being tamaracks. Coming from back east, tamarack to me is a species that would be in the larch family. And, you know, we have tamarack back in the Midwest, but I didn't think they existed out here, given this is what I teach. And sure enough, they were referring to lodgepole pine, two completely different trees. But again, common names arose for that species out west. And again, using those names can be misleading because it could refer to two completely different things, like it did in this case, tamarack, which is a sort of deciduous conifer tree, versus lodgepole pine, which is in a totally different group of conifers. So again, scientific naming is what we call unambiguous and universal because, again, it involves Latin, which again is a language that is not changing at this point. So every living thing on the planet has a unique species. So think of the word specific. It refers to one thing, right? One specific thing. And that is where the word species comes from. So for example, we have a couple of birds here, a robin and possibly a robin. So for us, in the United States and California, I'm sure everyone has seen the bird on the upper left, which we refer to as the American robin. But the bird in the bottom right is also a robin. It's just that it happens to be a species that lives in Europe. And so it's related, but it's a completely unique bird that is not the same robin as we have out here. Another one is the blue jay. Back east, again, where I come from, we had blue jays, and that was their common name. I get out west here, and again, a lot of people refer to those birds that we have out here as blue jays. So they are a member of the jay family, whether we're talking about the scrub jay or the Steller's jay. But other than the fact that they are mostly blue in color, they are not the common bird we refer to as a blue jay, which is an eastern United States species. But again, I tend to hear people just referring to both of those birds out here as blue jays. And then, of course, other things, you know, not all fish are fish. We refer to the species on the right side there of the screen as a jellyfish versus the normal, more typical fish with fins that we think of. Lobsters, some people kind of call them fish, right? Or at least they say we're fishing for lobster or we're fishing for crab. And again, there's nothing wrong with using these kinds of names. You have to realize who you're speaking with. If you're talking to a commercial fisherman, they're typically not really going to care, you know, taxonomically speaking, you know, whether a jellyfish is or isn't a fish. But if you're a scientist, then of course you're going to be referring to these unique living things with their Latin name. And so basically, Carl Linnaeus is the person who came up with the system that we use today. And there are two main characteristics of Linnaeus's system. And that is, as I've already mentioned, each species, each unique living thing, has a two-part name, and we refer to that as being binomial, two binomial, referring to name. So every living thing has a two-part name, and every living thing is part of a hierarchy, where we, again, classify living things that are related with respect to each other into broader and broader categories. So things that are members of the same genus are more similar to each other. Things that are members of the same family are still similar, but less so. And as we work up the hierarchy, we get more and more general or more and more broad. So it's important that this hierarchical system, or that you understand the hierarchical system of classification, basically goes from very broad categories like the kingdom Animalia, which includes all kinds of animals. And again, that could be everything from a jellyfish to a slug, to a bird, to a human. It's as we go through the system, we start narrowing down the characteristics from all animals to animals that have a vertebrate, like we do, but jellyfish don't, to groups like mammals, again, of which we are a mammal, as are dogs and cats and bears and deer. And then as we start becoming more and more narrow in the classification, we go from something like a mammal to something like a carnivore versus an herbivore, to something like a cat versus a dog versus a human, to then something like a mountain lion versus a tiger, etc. So again, think about as we work our way up from a species, we're looking at, again, broader classifications. So the way this binomial system works is that the first part of each name of every unique living thing is going to be a genus, a member of a genus. And then, in this case, the critter that we have pictured here is a member of the genus Felis, as you might have guessed. We think of commonly calling our pet cat or a mountain lion or a tiger a feline. And again, that's because the actual genus is Felis. And then the second part of that binomial system is the species. So every living thing on the planet is a unique species. So in this case, Felis and Catus is the genus. We might have Felis rufus, which would be a bobcat, or Felis concolor, which would be a mountain lion. So again, everything within the genus Felis has certain characteristics that make them similar to each other. Again, I think everybody can agree, for the most part, that if you see an animal, you could decide if it is or isn't a cat, some sort of cat. And again, in this case, Felis catus is the Latin, complete binomial Latin name for our domestic cat. So we'll look at the hierarchy now and how that works. So again, what we're trying to do is group species into a list, basically, of categories that go from the specific living thing, like Felis catus, to the very broad category that cats are, for example, examples of animals. They're not plants, they're not algae, they're not fungi. So again, we have two members of the genus Felis, but two different species, related, but more similar to each other than they are to a dog or to a bear or to a human, but still unique living things. If we look at plants, for example, I think most people could look at a tree around Northern California and say, oh, that's an oak tree. And again, you have in your mind maybe what an oak tree looks like, the shape of it maybe, the type of leaves. But certainly if you think about what, for example, oaks all have in common with each other is the type of fruit that they make, right? The seed, which are acorns. So any tree that has an acorn as its fruit is going to be a member of the genus oak, which is Quercus. Again, we can probably look at trees and go, oh, that's a maple tree. And again, it could be for a lot of reasons, general shape of the leaf, the fact that maples all have this type of fruit called a samara. So it's a seed right there with a nice little feathery wing on it. And that wing has a specific evolutionary purpose, right? It basically works like a little helicopter when it falls off the tree. So it kind of moves away from the parent plant, hopefully to land in a good spot where it can grow. And again, these are all members of the genus Acer, but there are a lot of different species of maples. And then we look at conifers, or again, a real general name for trees that we associate with pines, spruces, firs. Redwoods and giant sequoias are related, but a little less so than pines, spruces, firs, that kind of thing. And these are all a bunch of different genera. There's Pinus for the pines. There's Cupressaceae for the cypresses. Picea for the fir trees, or at least some of the fir trees. So they're all more like each other, even though there are a bunch of different genera. Genera is plural for a genus, by the way. So then if we look at all of the members of all of the genera that are under the broader group called Felidae, so again, you can kind of look at that word, Felidae, and kind of realize that we're talking about felines. So the domestic cat and the mountain lion are a little more similar to each other than either of them are to, say, the jaguar. Again, notice Panthera onca, a different genus. Lynx rufus. I think I said Felis rufus a little while ago. There's both of those are still used. I think today they're leaning more towards the bobcat being in a different genus from the domestic cat or the mountain lion. And so again, all of these are still cat-like. Felis, Panthera, lynx, and of course there are genera for the African lions and tigers and cheetahs, all different genera. But they are all under still the same family, Felis, or Felidae, I mean. And so then if we follow the domestic cat all the way out through the levels of hierarchy, we go from the species, catus, genus Felis. We just looked at the fact that they're under the family Felidae. So those are all kind of nice, right? They all kind of, kind of make sense. Feline, we think of feline, so those are all words that are similar. When we go out to the next broader category, now we have the order Carnivora. So everything that are in any of the families underneath the order Carnivora are basically meat eaters. Now, again, it doesn't mean they only eat meat. because you have cats and dogs. Dogs also, like coyotes, will also eat berries. You have the order Ursidae, or the family Ursidae, I mean, which are the bears. So you have a bunch of other living things under these orders called carnivora, or, again, carnivore, meat eater. Take another step out to even broader. Now we have the class Mammalia. And so under Mammalia, we could have carnivora, or we could have other orders that include animals like deer, which don't eat meat. And then those kinds of animals are even broken down into the number of hooves they have. Animals like horses that have just one hoof, deer that kind of have two-toed hooves. We take another broader step back to a phylum, which is Chordata. So every class, order, family, genus, species under the phylum Chordata are all living things that have a backbone, a bony spine. So even though, again, we now look at animals like the cat, there are other phylum that include things like the jellyfish. Jellyfish are still under the kingdom Animalia. They're more animal-like than plant-like. But, of course, jellyfish don't have spines. Insects are under the kingdom Animalia, but insects don't have backbones, right? They've got an outer shell. And then the broadest category here would be a domain. So there is a domain called Eukarya, which actually is in reference to the nucleus of every cell that's in these living things, certain characteristics about the way the cells are arranged. So there's prokarya, which are things like bacteria and so forth. So again, all we're doing is going from a very specific living thing to living things that are under categories that are more broad as we go all the way up through the domain. As we look at the classification of living things, part of that is also based on what we refer to as phylogeny, which addresses how living things are related to each other as they've evolved over time. So the evolutionary history of living things. And this is kind of what we refer to as the tree of life. Talk about, family trees for humans, right? You've got the original members of your family, and then every time the branch goes off, the children grow up, get married, have their own kids. Those kids grow up, get married, have their own kids. And so you start off with the trunk of the tree, with the ancestors, and then you go out to all of the relatives off into the future. It's the same idea here. That's basically what a phylogenetic tree is. And so how this relates to basically evolution is that we're looking at what are called homologous structures. Again, we're trying to organize living things into categories where they have similarities to each other. So for example, all mammals have certain things in common with each other that birds don't have, that reptiles don't have, that fish don't have, that insects don't have. Mammals all have hair on their body. They all give live birth, which some fish do, some reptiles do. Birds all lay eggs, but again, some reptiles lay eggs, some fish lay eggs. Mammals also have mammary glands where the females produce milk, and that's the food for the young. Birds, reptiles, fish, basically they hatch out and they're on their own to find food. All members of the order Carnivora, which again is a subgroup of the class Mammalia, have common structures that aren't found in other members of the class Mammalia. Again, carnivores have certain types of teeth. Their digestive systems are unique. And, the way they hunt and a lot of other things are special to them that, again, don't occur in other members in the class Mammalia. So here's just a little piece of a phylogenetic tree, for example. If we start at the base of the tree, the main the main stem of the tree with the order Carnivora. And now we branch off into three other families. Felidae goes off in one direction, which includes the genus Felis, and then again the domestic cat, the mountain lion, etc. Notice in this case the next branch goes off, and then it branches again, one going off to Canidae, which are members of the dog family, Canis lupus, the wolf, Canis familiaris, all of our pet dogs. And so notice wolves and domestic dogs are also more closely related to each other because they branch off the same main part of the tree. There are other dog-like animals, coyotes, that branch off somewhere else. Foxes are kind of unique. They branch off somewhere else as well. And then the other branch represented on here is Mustelidae, which are the what we call mustelids, animals that have must glands. They use that to mark their territory. That branches off in one direction to the skunks, Mephitis. Striped skunks like we have around here is Mephitis. But there are also spotted skunks and European skunks. We have another genus, Lutra, which are our otters. This one happens to be the European otter, but we've got river otters and the ones that are out in the ocean. So just one example of a very small part of a phylogenetic tree, but I think you kind of get the idea how it works. So as we're looking at phylogenetics, we're looking for, again, living things that have similarities in their structure. And so we've got two ways of looking at this, homologous and analogous structures. Homologous structures have a similar origin in a common ancestor. So for example, whales and bats are both examples of mammals. People don't maybe think of whales as much as mammals, but they are. They give live birth, they feed their calves milk, etc. So the fins on a whale and the wings of a bat are homologous structures in that they both evolve from the same limbs that we have, our forearms, our arms. Or if you're a dog, it's your front legs, your forelimbs, right? The cat, same thing. And so evolutionarily, those, at some point, the common ancestor that led eventually, after hundreds of millions of years, led to the bat's front legs evolving into wings, and led to the whale's front legs evolving into fins, because those structures better suited their environment as they back up here. So again, you think of the four limbs of mammals or animals in general. Some are meant for walking, like in dogs and cats. Some are meant for, like in humans, our four limbs, our arms evolved to be able to hold things, right? Manipulate things, do work. The mammals that have wings like bats, again, they evolved for a whole different purpose. You think, aside from whales, things like seals, porpoises, all have flippers instead of front limbs because, again, they live in water and flippers going to be a better way to use your front limbs to help you swim. So those would be example of homologous structures. And basically, if you look at the bones in a bat's wing, in a whale's flipper, or in a human's arm, we all have the same bones. The only difference is in the bat, the fingers are very much elongated, that make up the outer part of the web of the wing. In the whales, they're way smaller. You know, all the bones are kind of compressed because they're formed into a fin, but they all still are there. All the bones that we find in our arm are going to be in every other member of the group that we're in. So we contrast that with what we refer to as analogous structures. Things that seem similar, like wings. Think of a bird's wing, a bat's wing, wings on a butterfly, that they're all for flight. So superficially, the purpose for having those structures, wings, is to allow you to fly. Flight allows you to cover more ground, to find food, find mates. It allows you to be able to chase prey or be able to escape from a predator. So those structures evolved to have a similar purpose, but they do not have the same origin. There are no bones in a butterfly's wings. And even though both of these are animalia, members of the animal group, and they both have wings, the wings did not evolve from basically like the same bones or the same structures. So again, both contribute to flight, but they are both different in evolutionary origin. The evolution of bones versus the different tissues that make up the wings in a butterfly. And so this example where these two living things that are, although they're both animals, they're still very different from each other evolutionarily. And if you look at the phylogenetic tree of animals, they're very different places on that tree. They both, over evolutionary pressures, evolved and converged to both have wings. Again, for similar purposes. So that's an example of convergent evolution. The two unrelated species evolve similar structures for a purpose, like flight in this case. So maybe you can think about other species that are not related, maybe that have similarities in structures or how they look. We already used the example of things like whales having fins or flippers, tails that are modified to be able to swim, like fish. So again, fish and whales are only, related in that they're mammals and vertebrates. But they also would be an example of convergent evolution where, because of the environment they live in, being water, it's more efficient to have a wide, flattened tail to propel you through the water, and then flattened fins to be able to help steer you in the water. So the question sometimes that pops up is the question that pops up deals with kind of evolution versus maybe not believing in the idea of evolution, the fact that things evolve. We know that some basic principles that drive the universe are that things come from somewhere. They don't come from nothing. So how did we ever get something? If we didn't have species before, how did we end up with living things from nothing? And there's a lot of ways to look at this. There's the idea that all of the organic molecules, are out there in the ocean before there were, at some time before there were living things, and the right conditions, some molecules combined in a certain way, maybe got a spark of energy from lightning or something, and these very, very simple living things were formed from these organic molecules and different conditions. There's some of those ideas that, life was kind of seeded here from another planet, that not a different species of aliens, but theoretically then we could all be aliens, whatever those microorganisms were that, made it to Earth from outer space, that ultimately after billions of years led to us and all the other living things on the planet. Or, any number of different explanations for how life got started. I guess my personal philosophy is that, You don't necessarily have to say that either you believe in a god or you believe in something like evolution. My thought is, why couldn't God have created the first single-celled organisms, you know, the first life on the planet billions of years ago, and then made up, you know, the set of rules for life to follow? We know there are things in the universe that are constants, or basically you could maybe call them rules, and then just let life evolve and diversify over time. So again, it's not really the purpose of the class to get into that much more beyond that, but ultimately the life that we have on the planet, all of the different living things, did evolve from other living things that existed before them, going back to when we were basically 4.5 billion years ago with just single-celled organisms. And then given a lot of time and different environments that these living things have to adapt to, whether they adapt to living in water, and then, over time, characteristics like fins and flattened tails are selected for, or just all the different conditions on land that lead to different species of living things. We've got lizards that look like lizards. We've got other things that are similar that are more aquatic, like salamanders. And then we've even got lizards like this guy that looks like a snake. Again, a lot of people think of looking at this, you don't see legs, and you assume it's a snake because it doesn't have legs. But taxonomically, it's a lizard. And of course, snakes and lizards are also more like each other than they are like, other species. But there are amphibians like frogs, lizards, whether it's reptiles, I mean, whether it's lizards or snakes. But it really is the hardest concept to get a handle on, the idea of how long life has been on this planet, and that given billions of years, life can change and adapt to the conditions it lives in. It gets warmer and warmer and warmer. Species are going to have to adapt to that warmer climate, or they go extinct. Some adapt, some go extinct. You get a condition changing to be much colder, like an ice age. Again, species are either able to adapt to those colder conditions or they don't, and then they go extinct. So we've been talking about species, so make sure we have a definition of what a species is. So it's basically a group of living things or a group of populations whose members of that population have the potential to interbreed. So a unique species can breed with members of the same species and, very importantly, and produce fertile offspring. So these offspring are still they're still the same species, they're still similar to the parents, and so they can also reproduce. Over time, these different species can actually go through a process called speciation, which basically is a process where if, for example, there's a population of a given species, again, let's just, you can pick anything, it doesn't really matter, but say there's a species of bird, and it's widespread over a big area. But then over time, again, evolutionary time, millions of years perhaps, you get something like a mountain range that starts pushing up because of processes we talked about near the beginning of the class, right? Subduction, you've got mountain range being created, and suddenly now you have a mountain range like the Sierra Nevada. Or over time, you have an area that gets drier and drier and becomes a desert. Or even a really large river. If you're a mouse, the Sacramento River is a barrier. for you. You can't. You're not going to just jump in the river and start swimming to get across it. If you do, you might become salmon food, or you might get carried down river and drowned. If you're a small mammal like a mouse, you're not going to be able to go through a big desert to get to the other side of it. You're not going to be able to, you know, hike over a mountain range to get to the other side. So anytime that there are barriers that develop, where you have a species that's on both sides of the barrier, again, say a small rodent species, and you have that same species that now gets separated as a desert develops or mountain ranges, you know, grow over time. And again, we're talking about hundreds of thousands, if not millions of years. Suddenly you have barriers. The species on either side of that barrier can no longer interbreed with each other. And then now, because you probably have different conditions on either side of that barrier, those species start adapting to their new environment. And that could result in them evolving, you know, different adaptations. And if that barrier is in place long enough, those species, again, are likely to evolve in different ways to adapt to their new environment. That eventually means that they go through speciation, which means they become different species from each other. So they may still be members of the same genera, but now they become different species, which means they no longer are able to breed. And then, given enough time, they evolve into completely different things. So there can be temporal isolation that affects the ability of these individuals to mate. Plants that flower at different seasons or different times of the day. Animals that evolve to be out at night only versus animals that are only out during the daytime. So if things are separated by time, so again, night versus day, when things are ready to reproduce, then that type of barrier could result in speciation. Habitat isolation is the example I was just using. Species on being separated by deserts or mountain ranges or water, oceans, rivers, whatever, where populations that live in these different areas just never meet each other. They don't have the, they have a physical barrier, basically a fence, a barrier that they can't get across. Big desert, mountain range, the ocean. And so again, because they don't meet, because they live in different places, they don't reproduce and they go through speciation. Or it could even be behaviorally, that they have little or no attraction between different members of different populations. And again, there could be a lot of examples of how species have differences in their behavior. So these are basically barriers that preclude mating, or pre-mating barriers. So if the species can't find each other, if members of the same species but different populations can't find each other, they can't mate. So we have Western spotted skunks and Eastern spotted skunks, just literally, you know, a species that occurs out west of the Mississippi versus the one that's east of the Mississippi, I believe. And so they basically are temporarily isolated. The Western spotted skunk breeds in the fall, but the Eastern breeds late winter time. Again, very similar, both obviously members of Mustelidae, family Mustelidae, and they're both skunks, but they're isolated time-wise. They evolve different times of the year when they breed. So given time and the fact that they isolated from each other, they evolved into different species. Again, still very similar, but different. We could zero in on a couple of species of garter snakes that are actually in California. You might see some overlap here in the habitat, but basically the terrestrial garter snake uses dry land to hunt for its food items. and it'll eat, you know, anything small enough that it can catch, small lizards, even small rodents, baby mice, for example. But it hunts on dry land. That's why it's called the terrestrial garter snake. Whereas the aquatic garter snake has evolved a more aquatic lifestyle. They don't live exclusively in the water, but that's where they hunt for food. I actually had one in my goldfish pond a few years ago. My wife walked out back to feed them, and something looked weird, and there was a snake in our little pond that had a goldfish kind of halfway in its mouth. Of course, she grabbed the snake and shook the goldfish out, shooed the snake away. We didn't kill it, of course. We just took it down to the other end of our property. But they're both garter snakes. They're both similar. They evolved some different colors, as you can see. But most importantly, they live in different habitats. They look for food in completely different types of habitats, dry land versus aquatic. And here we have the infamous blue-footed booby, what we call a sort of a pelagic type of ocean bird, spends most of its life out over the ocean or on the ocean, comes to land just to breed and lay eggs. But birds especially use a lot of different behaviors to attract a mate. It could be their songs, their calls. It could be body movements, like you see the guy on the left there doing a little dance. And so, again, you could have just the way that these birds attract a mate. Again, evolving different calls, evolving different body movements. And then those birds only respond to that specific, you know, behavior, the displays that are basically there to attract mates. And so that can happen over time as well, where isolated groups, because of the conditions they live in, just evolve different behaviors. And so even if they happen to come in contact with each other at some point in the future, because they have different ways of attracting mates, they don't breed with each other. There are sometimes what we call mechanical barriers, like in flowers, for example. Some flowers might have a really deep funnel where the pollen is way down deep inside the flower. And so only, for example, a bird that has a long curved beak can even reach down into that. And so then structurally that flower may have evolved a shape that allows maybe one species of bird that has just the right shape beak to get into there and be able to, you know, get to the pollen. And of course then that means the flower, the pollen can be transferred and the flower can, you know, can reproduce. Or in animals it could even be just different types of genitalia, shapes or placements of the genitalia that would preclude different species from physically being able to copulate and therefore produce fertile offspring. Could even be at the gamete level that the isolation is gametic, or in other words, the female and the male gametes, the egg and the sperm, don't unite for again, any number of reasons. So these are all examples of barriers for failed mating attempts. Again, these two different species could be in the same place at the same time, so we don't have those types of barriers, but because of differences in structures, they're physically unable to mate. And again, whether we're talking about flowers or animals, if the parts don't match up, then that would be a barrier to mating. We also get conditions in nature where we create hybrids. Plants are far more likely to create hybrids than animals are, but it does happen. So hybrid inviability basically is where we have the zygote, again the male sperm or the female egg, because it's different, is unable to actually develop for whatever reason, and therefore it's not going to reach sexual maturity. We also have hybrid sterility, where the hybrids basically don't even produce gametes that are functional, that can actually result in fertilization. Or we can have what's called hybrid breakdown, where the hybrids are just sterile. So these are post-mating barriers. Now again, when we have animals and plants in captivity, and we try to breed different things to different things, we can create, humans can create hybrids. And we do it all the time for agriculture. Plants that have bigger fruits or combinations of things, plums and apricots that we've created pluots out of. But again, what we're doing here is we're assuming that these animals are wild, not captive animals. And so these are naturally occurring sort of post-mating barriers. And maybe in animals, the best example is when we breed a horse and a donkey. Again, you can tell by looking at horses and donkeys that they're similar to each other. They have similarities. They both look like they are related. And they actually can breed. They can actually produce an offspring, which we refer to as a mule. And mules have characteristics that we value for different things. But mules are actually sterile hybrids. In other words, if it was a horse breeding with another horse, we would produce a horse as an offspring, and then that offspring horse could reproduce with another horse in the future and make a horse. In this case, when we have a horse and a donkey creating what we refer to as a mule, the mule cannot breed with another horse or another donkey or another mule. So it basically is a sterile hybrid. We can keep breeding horses and donkeys to make more mules, but mules can't breed with mules to make mules because they are sterile. So we talked about speciation being the evolutionary process of a species being separated in any number of ways: time, physical barriers, reproductive barriers, and given enough time, things evolving to be different species that can no longer reproduce, meaning they're again unique species. A couple ways this can happen. We refer to allopatric speciation when we have geographic barriers that isolate populations. Again, imagine going from a habitat to then over millions of years having a mountain range now. And either we had a species of fir tree, let's say, and as that mountain range developed, the fir trees kind of disappeared from the mountain because it's no longer suitable habitat. But you've got a population of fir trees on the west side of the mountain, and you have that population of fir trees on the east side of the mountain. Again, given enough time, these populations are isolated from each other by a geographic barrier. And then, given enough time, they speciate or become related but different species. So that's an example of allopatric speciation. Sympatric speciation occurs when you don't have a geographic barrier. This could be something more like a sort of a random genetic mutation. So again, we have a species of some sort of tree, and then we have certain individuals that have maybe some slight genetic differences, and they create viable offspring that survive. But given, again, maybe millions of years, that species that was once one species now creates this slightly different pool of genetic material. And again, given over time, millions of years, you might have a population that's within the population that it derived from. but yet that, again, given enough time, it evolved to be a different species. So that would be called sympatric speciation, when you have one species evolve into two different species, but in this case there's no barrier. It just happened with those random genetic mutations that that tend to be one of the reasons why things evolve and change over time. So again, a few terms there to work with: understanding, taxonomy, how phylogenetic trees are organized, the hierarchy, going from kingdoms, which are very broad groups of living things, through phylums, class, order, family, genus, down to then every unique species of living thing. The idea of speciation and the ways that things can speciate, again, being separated by barriers or behavioral barriers, etc. So, next lecture that you'll be looking at up next week is going to be starting to get into some identification. So in your National Audubon Society field guide, there's a lot of really good images in the second half of the book that will help you start being able to identify living things around you. And we're going to start with the algae, fungi like mushrooms and lichen, which are the living things over here on this rock or piece of wood. And so we're going to really start getting into paying attention to the living things around you, and you're going to start trying to identify some of these things for your field notes.